Hachette Audio presents Kirk and Anne, Letters of Love, Laughter, and a Lifetime in Hollywood. Written by Kirk Douglas, Anne Douglas, with a foreword by Michael Douglas. Read by Cameron Douglas and Kelsey Douglas. Please enjoy the PDF of photos that accompanies this audiobook.
If you're a movie star, you get all the credit. But my wife deserves more than half. To my wife, Anne, this book is dedicated to you. KD.
This is the story of an unending love affair for my husband and friend, Kirk. AD.
Foreword by Michael Douglas. The secret to a great play is its third act. If the audience is still engaged by the story, enthralled with the characters, and surprised by what it sees, the playwright has created magic. Kirk and Anne is a book overflowing with magical stories. Their life together has been filled with romance and drama, great triumphs and heartbreaking tragedies, and a glamorous Hollywood lifestyle. If their letters reveal anything about Kirk and Anne Douglas, it is that from the very beginning, they were opposites who could not help but attract. Each of them brings out the very best in the other. My father Kirk wears his heart on his sleeve, while Anne protects hers with a caution born of bearing life's burdens with dignity and strength. Yet it is that very protective quality that makes her the lioness that she is. She used it to take care of all of us, especially my father. I remember as a young boy, after my father and my mother Diana divorced, not only did Anne treat my brother Joel and I as though we were always a family, she invariably showed great love and respect to our mother. With Anne's characteristic dry wit, she referred to her as our ex-wife. In their third act, Kirk is still enthralled by Anne, as she is by him. My father recently told me Cole Porter loved Anne. Think of it, a young woman from France, newly arrived in Hollywood in the early 50s, and married to one of the world's biggest movie stars, is invited to accompany her husband to a dinner party hosted by the legendary lyricist-composer. It is the star's young wife, with her European style and effortless grace, who delights their host. She is invited back and told, "You may bring your husband too, if you must." This book begins with the passionate and poignant story of their courtship as revealed through their never-before-published letters. It then follows their seven-decade journey through happiness and hardship, annotated by their correspondence with the influential and remarkable people who have shared that journey with them. If this book is the curtain for their third act, I can't wait for their fourth. Michael Douglas, January 2017. Introduction. Movie directors call the fleeting moments when sunset approaches the magic hour. Some of the most memorable moments in film history have been shot in the last light of day. In our house, we celebrate it as the golden hour, a time to reflect and connect, to recall and relive some of the magic hours that have filled our enduring union of more than 60 years. When we reminisce about our courtship, we could never have imagined our new love growing into a lifetime of these golden hours. Some of them have followed painful, heartbreaking days. We made it through even the hardest of them, because at the end, we had each other. One evening, when we were sitting in front of the fire in the great room of our Montecito home, I, Kirk, asked my wife if I had ever sent her love letters. She smiled mysteriously at me. "Would you like to see them?" she asked. "I'll be right back." She returned with a battered-looking manila file folder filled with flimsy airmail envelopes, letters on pages from the yellow-lined legal pads we used at home, and dashed-off notes on odd slips of paper. Some of them, the kind of billet doux that lovers write just because.
I, Anne, have very few mementos from my early life before Kirk. In the turbulent years before and during World War II, I moved from Hanover to Brussels and then to Paris, taking only the essentials each time. As a result, the letters and memorabilia of our life together were even more important to me. My main repository for the collection has been the climate-controlled wine cellar of our Beverly Hills home, which I call the dungeon. It is filled with boxes of letters and photographs from friends and fans, from Hollywood royalty and political leaders all over the world. Most harken back to a kinder, gentler time when writing notes in one's own handwriting was considered a mark of courtesy. I admit the handwriting on some of them is hard to decipher, mine included. The intimate letters of our courtship and marriage have been hidden for many years, in a secret spot in my Montecito bedroom. I haven't looked at them since I put them there, but they are very precious to me. I saved whatever Kirk wrote me, of course, but over the years I also collected my letters to him. I would find them in the suitcases I unpacked when he came home from locations. I was happy to share them again with Kirk. As the golden hour faded into darkness that evening, we read a few of them aloud to each other in front of the fire. We both had forgotten how intensely we communicated after we fell in love in Paris in 1953, married in Las Vegas in 1954, and endured subsequent separations because of film commitments. In addition to the long, newsy letters, there were cables, notes scribbled in airplanes and between takes, and a few X-rated ramblings about how much we missed each other. It was like seeing them for the first time all these years later.
I, Kirk, have written 11 books over the years, some of them autobiographical, and 3 since I turned 90. Now in the beginning of my 100th year, I felt there was nothing new to say about my life or the people in it. For several years, I had toyed with the idea of writing a book of letters, based on the ones Anne had stashed in the dungeon. I couldn't find the right thread for a cohesive narrative and lost interest. Suddenly, I knew the missing ingredient. It was Anne. I had written about her many times, but how extraordinary to read how she felt about her life with me, its opportunities, its drawbacks, its pleasures and pains. I looked at my wife. "I'll tell you what's in here," I said, tapping on the precious file before me. "It's our book. Anne and Kirk Douglas, April 2016. Chapter 1, When We Were Young. Kirk. I know little about my immigrant parents' early life in Russia. Fiddler on the Roof is a sanitized version of their shtetl world at the dawn of the 20th century. During a pogrom, my mother, Bryna Sanglel, saw a Cossack murder her brother. She had no pleasant memories of the old country, at least none that she ever shared. After I became the Hollywood star, Kirk Douglas, and Ma was living comfortably in the Jewish home for the aged in Troy, New York, she worried I would go to Russia. Her reaction was strong and immediate. This is from her letter of April 8, 1958, which she dictated to my sister. "Dear Anne and Kirk, I've heard from several people that they have heard about your Kirk being invited by Russia to make a picture there. This came as a big shock to me, and I pray to God that while I am alive, you will not go to Russia. I do not mind whenever and wherever you go elsewhere, but not to Russia. Please keep this in mind, as I am not young nor too well any longer, and these are my feelings. We are happy and proud of whatever you do, and we have heard too much unfavorable news about Russia to have you embroiled there. Stay well and happy, and write again soon. My dear son, God bless you. Love, Mother." We had no relatives in America except for my uncle Avram. He arrived a year before my father and changed his name from Danielovich to Dembski. Pa, Herschel Danielovich, the horse trader, became Harry Dembski, the ragman, after joining his brother in Amsterdam, New York. Pa was very strong, but the thriving local factories would not hire Jews. He bought a horse named Bill and a cart so he could buy old rags, scrap metal, and any other junk lying around people's homes. He took the day's haul to a dealer for pennies on the pound. The next year, he sent a steerage ticket for his young bride. Whether he paid for it himself.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.